Hello all, welcome to today's discussion on non-personal data and community, mostly questions around public data and community data, and also questions around privacy and the all-encompassing non-personal data framework. So my name is Shweta and I work at the Center for Internet and Society. Just a few things before, so we are ending the session around 6:55, so we'll try to keep it to the point and the discussions to the point. Also for questions for the participants, you can use the question and answer tab and put the questions there. Maybe at the end of the session, we might take like 10 minutes to just see what the questions are and ask the panelists to answer them. And just I think request for the panelists that y'all can self-introduce yourself, because just to keep the time really short. So you can start,
Thank you so much, Shweta. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Thank you so much. And hello, everyone. I think we all are seeing each other after a really long time. My name is Tripti Jain. I'm a researcher at the Internet Democracy Project. And I've looked at a couple of these frameworks in the last 1 year since they have been incepted. And today I'll be mostly talking about community data and mostly from the embodied perspective.
Srikant?
Hi everyone, I'm Srikant. I run a collective called Cashless Consumer, which looks at digital payments. Today I'll be focusing on the community related aspects, more from a consumption as well as a production standpoint on producing and consuming non-personal data.
We have Anivar.
Hi. I'm Anivar Aravind. I'm a public interest technologist, also part of a community called Swatantra Malayalam Computing, which is working in the last 20 years on language computing domain. We do quite a lot of work with various data sets related to language, which may be relevant to the community data framework we are discussing. So anyway, we will come into that question when the time arrives.
Right. And we have Prasanna.
Hello all, this is Prasanna. I'm a litigating lawyer based out of Delhi. I'm an advocate on record of the Supreme Court. And I also am founder trustee Article 21 Trust, which works looks at the issues at the intersection of digital rights and welfare.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. And I think it's also this whole discussion around community data is very pertinent, because HASGEEK is also a community, and it's very important to know what the government or what the legislators think about community data or data from community. I think the first question I have is around, so I think the term community data, I think, started when the PDP bill, the Personal Data Protection Bill 2018 version came out and talk about community data, but didn't specify what. And there's also a discussion about what can be included in community data. Is it about a certified group of people, or is it just a larger group of people? So does the NPD framework, does it give a clarity on what the community data is or what community rights are? I'm asking Prasanna, Anivar, and Tripti. So let's start with Prasanna.
The question is whether the NPD report makes it clear as to what community data is. Yeah, the answer has to be in the negative. But I am not so sure that if the framework itself was to make it clear what community data is. In fact, the framework, I would still take the first report framework as the starting point. I'd say, in fact, at the first report, at least made, I thought, an honest attempt to say that, see, merely because somebody collects the data, they don't get to be the owners of the data. I think that was an important step forward, right? So it's been taken as a default that merely because a company or an entity collects the data, they get almost all the rights, like owners, like a copyright in that particular data that they've collected or collated or combined. So to depart from that default proposition to say that, no, merely because that's not the case, it is still all regulatable field. It's the wilderness that, I mean, it's just that you all enjoyed so much because it's been the wilderness so far, but the state has to come in, has to regulate it and look at other interests as well in that data, including community interests. So that, I think, was an important breakthrough in the report number one. In fact, that I didn't share the pessimism that a lot of us did share about the report one as to whether it was, it was trying to aspire for too much, too soon and all of that. But the second report has significantly gone back on that. Right, it has, in terms of the framework, it has gone back. It has, in fact, cited Copyright Act 2.0. I mean, that particular provision was made in 92 when data as a business was not even in contemplation. Right, so at that time, yes, I mean, if you had compiled the data, so you pretty much got the copyright over that. And there is no reason absolutely for the NPD framework to retain that. In fact, to retain that and hardwire it in the law, to say that merely because you collect or you collate or you compile, that you get ownership rights over that data, that certainly hurts community interests. It certainly hurts sort of state interests, national interests at whatever level that we want to define. So that's where I come from. In this case, yes, if the question is, if the NPD makes it clear as to what community data is, what individual data is, and what private data is, it certainly does not. But I'm not sure if that is what they set out to answer.
Tripti, so I think I missed. I also wanted to ask about community rights. So that also, I think Tripti can help with that in terms of, does it make it clear what the rights the community has, not only what happens to their data, but also what rights they have in terms of recourse?
I think like how Prasanna said and illustrated very well for us that the report fails to like clarify what does community data even mean to begin with, to have a framework in place that which we can criticize or even think about further. Like the earlier draft, they did make an earnest attempt, or I mean to say that, you know, where they said things like just relaying through what Prasanna just said, because that's the reality of the story, that there was an attempt where they said that that, you know, people who actually the bodies from whom the data emulates, they also have certain rights over that data, and they need to be enabled to have a control over that data, and they need to be, they should have autonomy over that data. It wasn't said in these terms, but this is what the intent seemed to be. However, it did not translate into even the framework that was proposed then, because even then, what we see is that there's a lack of attention to power relations. And it is very evident in the way the committee or the report proposes to ensure participation of communities. For example, they say that, you know, the data that is related to people, they should be enabled, that data trustees will exercise data rights on behalf of the community. So, but are these trustees, how will they be put into place? There is hardly any discussion on that. The committee fails to discuss that in detail. How would those people be purposed? How will those people be put into place? If really the idea is to enable people to have an autonomy over the rights of their over their data and over their community data, these things need to be clearly defined and even thought about that. Do we even... Is the answer lie in having a community data? To what extent can we build data on the can we build communities on the basis of data? Because the way these things have been discussed currently, it's very vague. Two people who have similar sort of data would be put together in a community, but do they even belong to the same community? For what purpose is this community being created for? And even if we were to delineate all of those things, have we really thought about when we create a community and we create trustees or say custodians of that community, we are again creating relationships of subordination and relationships of power. So how would that power really trickle down, and how to not enable that, how to actually facilitate people to exercise their rights. Those are the few things which I fail to see in either of the two drafts. And that's very disconcerting, in fact.
Right. I think we'll go back. We'll come later to the question around data trustees, and we have a longer discussion on that. Ayuvar, yes, for someone who works in the community, you must be looking at it more like, okay, what can I learn from here? What do I need to do towards the community with regard to the framework? So what do you think?
Continuing from Prasanna and Supti, the first thing I wanted to say is the problem with the framing and the definition itself. If you look at even the way community is defined in various laws and policies in India, there are at least two examples here. One is the Panchayati Raj extension to scheduled areas, which have a clear sense of community and the governance over the resources, which includes livelihood and socioeconomic and everything. Similarly, the Forest Rights Act also have a sense of community and governance and over livelihood and the resources. And while we coming directly to data, this is all defined totally in an economic context alone, just like the PDP bill. So the problem here is, is it economic context or alone, or is it, how is the governance of this is addressed, is a critical question. So in the similar, the definition of community in the even on the V2 draft, it's a very problematic definition. And the third sense of community is basically, it's not a legal definition, but how internet functions is primarily communities which organize together on similar interest basis. So the other two may be the local basis, one of the things I can clearly see on the draft at this point is the user agency as well as the trust of the communities each other is totally changed into something like, this community is something like the CSR approach to community. Companies can create their CSR foundation in the same way they can create their own definition of community by pooling some people together. It may not be the locally relevant participatory decision-making community which is relevant to the context. So this is where I think we need to actually look at the definition of community itself. And coming back to the second part, which is basically the community data part. So the right to organize is not limited to the, we are talking about this is in a context of very legal framework in India. In India, you know that it's very difficult to do a legal organization always. If you look at internet, if you look at online communities, most of them are not legal trust or formations or anything. If you look at free and open source project, they are not legal project always. Even if you look at the COVID-19 data sets and the collaborations building on top of it, maybe COVID-19 related various data sets. It's basically communities coming together, maybe during a disaster or maybe during a important need using technology. And they may be addressing data, but the automatically what happens is when we moving into very legal framework of trust society and maybe Section 8 companies, it's basically taking away the rights of people from the process and making it as a corporate instrument.
Thank you. I think I just move along the same conversation around community and public good comes to the idea of public good. So I think something that I think the AI reports also, and I think the economic survey chapter spoke about data as a public good, data for the people, by the people, and of the people. So I think I'll start with Ayuvar first, and let him continue with the idea of a public good and community data, and then we'll also ask Shrikant and Tripti.
In public good and community, I think we already have a public good approach to data in existing for at least for last 10-15 years, which is basically if you look at Wikidata or OpenStreetMap or Wikipedia, it's basically people creating data sets, which may be content data sets or the over a map data set or a similar kind of data sets, and various open licensing, like even open data licenses there, which by OKF and which actively used in OpenStreetMap and various other projects. If you, for example, we are maintaining dictionaries as open data. We have a project called Grantham, which have almost all the published books in Indian Malayalam from the first print history to at least 1995 onwards, on which library which book have. So so this is basically by people licensing data sets under a free license. So that's basically, that's where user agency is an important component. And basically the licenses protect it from ensuring it as a public good. But while we are changing that, this is one of the problem with the V1 report primarily, because copyright versus this conflict was there. But right now, they, even though they are trying to address it, the agency part is still not addressed. And the communities are formed by trust. Trust of maintaining the public good. But that trust is not a legal instrument alone. It's for example, 10 years, a community like Swandra Malayalam Computing or maybe similar communities in various Indian languages existed as just online collectives. So here we are doing an organizing based upon a value. It can be high value data set or an economic value, which is not the way communities function. Public good is mostly many of the ways communities organize. And the governance structure also, which may be locally relevant in some cases, which may not be nationally relevant. If one project, we can see one developer initiated projects, which may be handling a lot of data, but organized as free software or and even data sets are released under open data licenses. For I can tell you an example of maybe a dictionary created by a Karnataka scholar. Right now available as a free data set. I think I forgot its name. Yeah, so it's developed over the years and people contribute to the same data sets. So there are various examples of this and how it is happening, but at the same time, all these existing practices are totally failed to recognize in the framework. And also we can also see too much centralization interest around this, which is also happening in many, along with the COVID pandemic and the way we are becoming digital. So there is the distributed nature of data as well as organizing is totally need to be studied by the committee. And I think the personal and non-personal data categorization does not apply many of the times, because there is always a extension of community to data in many cases, which may not be, which is sometimes personal, which is sometimes community identity wise. So identity is part of this data set. If you look at the forest data or the forest dwellers data, you can see those rights are recognized in Forest Rights Act. But while moving to data, this is mostly just like we see on PDP bill, it's a dehumanized approach to data and data set as mostly as a technology terminology alone.
I think Tripti will have some more thing around, and also I think it adds again to the question about hierarchy and data. So about, and also question around data as a public good. So what do you, can you explain about what you feel about the whole NPD and how the whole public data for public good, non-personal data for public good? Right.
So as Anivar very well put, the approach from where it starts, that you know what. When we start looking at data as public good and non-personal data specifically as public good, the way the committee perceives it, it perceives data in the very first place as binaries, like personal and non-personal data has been perceived as binaries. And that is the first assumption where we start seeing the problem. And the way I look at data, the way we at Internet Democracy Project look at data that is embodied and that data that is emulated out of individuals is an extension of our bodies. And to there may be some data that that is aggregated or is appropriated and which is not related to individuals. But that line needs to be defined differently. But the way this report does it is a problem in itself. And that is where the actual problem is. That is first point. The second point of it is that the way the report looks at it is that once individuals that produce data or that data is anonymized, that data becomes automatically public. And that means, like, you know, we sort of are infrastructures. Like, you know, there, like, you know, we can draw parallels to how humans in economic processes are looked at as human resources. And again, like, you know, when you look at humans as human resources, you reduce their value to mere economic value or, like, you know, an economic number. And their broader instrumental worth, which is social good or public interest, is actually looked over, because all that is left is that infrastructure, that economic value. And it also, again, like how you said, that it also again leads to establishment of a structure of subordination, because those who will accumulate this data, again, the way, you know, the high value data set creators, like Prasanna in the beginning said, that, you know, those people who will be, because there is no value, like the way they see data, that data on its own has no value. Individuals who are contributing to that data have no value. So people who will actually be accumulating data, processing data, only they are like able to accrue value out of that data. And then they would again be by the way this committee has drafted the report, those people again would be in power to delineate terms on how this data should be disbursed, shared, or valued. And people who actually are contributing bodies that actually have autonomy of that data will fail to have any voice. So this entire way of processing things, and, you know, under these categories is a problem, because the assumptions with which we start with which the committee has started drafting are the key issues here.
And Srikant, just to add, just also along with the public good questions, also around, do you have any experiences from working with the community and the difficulties that you find with the non-personal data framework? And also because of, yes, of the cashless consumer community. And so one question definitely is the public good, but also second is with regard to the community. And
okay, so first let me get to the community and data generation. So as a community, we generate data both organically and inorganically, so say so through RTIs. Now, RTIs were a crucial instrument of data that's already available with the regulator, which is getting shared because of the transparency law. Now, what we see with the technology regulation and the regulation of digital economy is the government clearly wanting to step aside from even having the statutory regulator. So at least when you have a statutory regulator, that regulator is bound by transparency laws to actually expose data. And what we are also not seeing in this report on NPD conversation itself is the previous reference to the NDSAP policy. Now, what happened to the whole open data movement, where the data is actually out there publicly for everyone, including individuals? So you don't need to necessarily belong to a community that's registered under Section 8 and so on. So what we see here is since the regulation around technology and digital economy is moving into some kind of a self-regulation mode, where these data trustees would act as a pseudo-regulators for the benefit of the industry. And since they are not bound by transparency laws, so you need some way out to get some data, which is probably why you need this NPD reasoning, because you no longer have the transparency law applicable to these private entities which organize based on the industry. That's because you failed to regulate the industry in the first place. So that's the self-regulation model seems to be kind of prioritized, and NPD is seen as some kind of saving grace for the state itself, because now the state has lesser and lesser control, because the state does not even have the statutory regulator around these industries. And this is not just technology. This could probably be tomorrow mining, it could be shipping, whatever industry, because as we move towards an economy which has minimum government, and the definition of minimum government seems to be getting smaller and smaller, we have gone to a point where regulators are saying that we are having too much work, why don't you regulate yourselves through self-regulatory organizations. So this will kind of weaken the state in the long run itself, not just communities, the state as such. An NPD will leave the state, it's obvious that we leave the communities at the mercy of these industries. We'll also leave the state kind of a lot weaker. So now that's on the NPD framing. On to the public good concept, the notion of public good needs a really harder look. People have kind of repeatedly pointed out something that generates value, economic value, as public good. Whereas what they've also done is also hailed privacy harming data centralization platforms as digital public good. And they justify that by using the Economist's definition of public good, which is like non-excludable, non-rivalrous. But that kind of discounts the negative externalities of the entire infrastructure. Say, for example, the costs of these infrastructure, let's say include digital exclusion, loss of privacy, cybersecurity risks, are all placed not on by the people who generate this data, but on a different set of people. And these are some of the examples of social harms of digital public goods. And social harms and public goods can perfectly coexist. And in fact, digital public goods will be blind to social harms. So it's while the word public good might seem like a very nice sweet to the ears, but we need to actually consider what it is more holistically, and then say, like, if public good can coexist with social harm so peacefully, is it really good for us?
You're muted, Shweta.
So the question, I think going back to the question on privacy, sorry, it's not privacy, sorry, transparency. I wanted to ask Prasanna about how the non-personal data framework speaks about IP rights, and does it give companies a way to hide their data or not share their data through IP protection?
I think it also certainly in the V2 of the report, I did see, V1 and V2, I don't see it as a seamless transition at all. As I said, V1 specifically took a view that it is by norm, it is either public or community data that doesn't belong to you, right? It is an exception that if it belongs to the individual or the company or the entity that is collecting, collating, or compiling the data. V2 has gone back to the position of the Copyright Act, where it has effectively said, once you have collected, collated, or compiled the data, you pretty much own the rights, because they cited the provision of the Copyright Act to say that. And to say there are exceptions that we create, those will be limited exceptions. In fact, the tone of the V2 report for me reminded that it was a significant backtracking. Perhaps at the instance of a lot of the criticism that was received by the V1 report, to say that, we are only now trying to tinker in the margins, right? There's a different question whether they are really only tinkering in the margins, or whether this tinkering in the margins is going to be enough, right? Because there was also a body of opinion that certainly came about saying that NPD. Looking at data as a business and how do we regulate that, including having provisions for specific delineation of individual rights, community rights, as well as national rights. So that's an important step forward. Right? As far as how do you marry the NPD framework with the IP framework, I think NPD framework will need to be one of the basket of measures, right? Much like you do have several regulators, the multiplicity of regulators, I think even in HASCIC survey has come out as one of the top concerns. But multiplicity of regulators is not something that we are going to wish away anytime soon. And that's true of any sector. And there's no reason why data as a business, those businesses that specifically look at data as business, have to be excluded from this compliance burden.
Yes, so I think that's another question about does the framework give prominence to businesses over communities in terms of IP at least? Sorry, Prasanna, yes.
Yes, it appears from the second version of the report. My reading of that is that yes. So that there's a significant bend over backwards to try and accommodate market interests and perhaps even sort of make the community interest secondary, which was not the case with the first version of the report, at least to my reading.
Thank you. I'll just go back to Anivar and ask the same question I asked Shrikant about what is the, as a member of a community or someone who runs a community, do you think what are the measures or what do you think the NPD data changes in terms of how the community is? And do you have to take any steps because of this framework?
I just want to add just one point to what Prasanna said before answering this question. So one is this... the copyright issue is still very active even after the NPD V2 report, because one of the things NPD, that Committee of Experts, failed to understand on the first report is there is both structured and unstructured data, and even on structured data, content is there is no specific difference between content and the so-called data engineer handling data sets. Even if you look at schema.org or any kind of well-defined structures around even various types of content or various type of data sets, so all of them are data. So, and what the committee fails to understand, that another thing at this point is the standards of organizing data. This is where what Srikant mentioned about the national policy on open standards is coming in. So 2012 policy. Which is basically an effort of force movements as well as various people working on the public good part of technology, maybe public good part of technology as well as data put up in last decade. And let's look at a distant look from 2010. 2010, we had another movement called Open Government Act. Open government data is basically government opening up its data to people. But while we are talking about NPD in 2020 or 21, this is all about people and businesses opening data to government as well as for sharing. So this is totally opposite of what the kind of openness we had in 2010. And the HVD definition does not actually bring anything new. It's basically makes it arbitrary to define for an authority or someone, and possibly it will end up as a business interest data sets. So actually there is no community in this process, and this is why I am calling this as CSR approach to community. So we have, and while we are mentioning about CSR approach to community, we also see how the CSR spendings are happening in this country, which may not be always beneficial to community. We have seen even CSR amount pooled together to build new health projects by the same set of companies through company pooling the efforts. We have seen it on ACT grants specifically. ACT grants during the COVID times to collate money from industry together to build another rails or industry to pool more data.
I think another question, my next question, is around privacy and non-personal and personal data. I think while I look at the work of what the ultimate goal of having all these data sets or data markets or data collated is to maybe to do analysis or run AI systems on it. So I think the harm also comes when not just the non-personal data, but also personal data and sensitive personal data is mixed with non-personal data, and then the results are made. So I'll start with Tripti first. Do you think these concerns are there, or are these? So is the concern also around the adding of data and data sets?
So before I jump into this question, I just want to say something in like what Prasanna said in earlier remark. It's not, I just don't feel that it is just this report which aims to realize the economic interest of non-personal data, but I think this has been the concern. I mean, I in my submission from Internet Democracy Project did highlight extensively that why across the report, the last one and this one, that they has like the committee experts do members do highlight that, you know, there's a social and public value to data, but at the same time, at every instance, what they aim to do and translate into action is only enabling economic interest and only realizing the economic value of data. And from whose perspective, like if you look in, like we need to ask that whose interest is being served and what are these policies being made for? If it is really to enable public good at large, then like, you know, who are involved in this process to begin with? I think the conversation starts back there. And that is why across the report, it is just, you know, these are through various symbols and through various categorizations, it becomes more apparent. Then moving on to the binary discussion that this committee sort of resorts to, which is how to distinguish between personal and non-personal data, and this, and you know, the safeguards that are again provided in the in the report in the version 1 and 2. Firstly, the line of separation between personal and non-personal data is often blurred, which this committee fails to see. Like it says that, you know, once there is there are no identifiable factors related to a human, the data becomes automatically non-personal. And again, even I consider even that as a high bar, but what they actually do in the report is once the data is anonymized, it automatically becomes bereft of an individual's its ability to harm an individual just suddenly automatically vanishes or gets invisibilized, which the committee aims, like, you know, looks at it in that manner, which is a very big problem. There are scholars like Rives David and Jackson Steven, and, you know, who have written extensively in raw data as an oxymoron, that data that is generated by human activities can truly be never non-personal because it is always contextualized. For example, just like images that are captured by a photographer, which are always framed, they are selected out of an experience in which this photographer stands, points, and shoots. So data similarly too needs to be understood as framed, and framing of the data too needs to be understood. And according to that, the uses to which it is put and can be put needs to be put into place. And even if we were to believe that, you know, there are categories in personal and non-personal data in which it can be segregated, it is very difficult to ascertain in which category the data falls. So for example, like currently it is framed as the way it is looked at in data protection regimes is between data controllers and data subjects. And there's a legal vacuum that already exists there because how a person who aims to control their data or control other people's data, the way they would look at that data would be very different from how we would look at the data. And if we go back to scholars like Shoshana Zuboff's interpretation of surveillance capitalism, the reason why it exists in the first place is because I give my data to, say, a Facebook, or a user gives their data to to any entity in order to enable a service. And that's how they see that they are giving their data. But the way that data is appropriated and then assessed and then contextualized, the meaning changes altogether. So there is no discussion about all of that. And there is no discussion about collective harms. And there are no clear transparency about what would automated decisions take place, how they would take place, the right to have a meaningful public input. There's no discussion about how sanctions would be enforced. Like, you know, how audits would take place. There is no discussion about all of these things in the report, and that is the major problem.
Muted. Yes, looking at data separately, like we have the personal data protection bill is coming, and then this whole new framework is coming. Plus, we have different sectoral data regulations like the healthcare data, financial data. So it's also very difficult to have all these different categories of data, which confuses people even more. And then the this is also in the community. So again, I'll ask Srikanth again about how is it easy to segregate non-person data in a community, for example, like in the while having a community, definitely there would be at least names of people or email, or so there's something that does define people. So how would you as a community think about what would be exactly the non-personal data and how you keep it different, completely separate from the personal data?
Okay, so just on before I answer that, just on privacy or right. Personal non-personal data, I just had a point to add. The annexure in the V2 report actually mentions eminent domain passed by reference. It even says that it's probably not correct or fair to consider it as eminent domain. But then it goes on to quote genetic data and stuff as something that a state should kind of have some sort of say, as a state kind of ensuring that community rights, which kind of places individual rights slightly below the community rights. So I mean, it's okay to it kind of gives to a point where it's okay to kind of give away on the individual right to privacy if there is a community rights perspective. So that is problematic. And if we kind of put in place the DNA regulation bill that's out there for decades now in place together, that's quite scary on privacy part, because then the state could actually use community rights and NPD itself to extract more data, which kind of harms privacy. So that's one. And then the other other thing is basically, even though the de-anonymization, again, we'll leave this to the technical discussion on how perfect it is possible to de-anonymize. That's a technical debate. But then even if hypothetically assuming that de-anonymization is perfectly foolproof, it still has a large chilling effect on communities as a whole. So while when this de-anonymized data sets get shared and published, and then that kind of generates, let's say, viewpoints, insights, decisions in various algorithmic systems, that is still going to impact people of that in subset of community as a whole. So the privacy harm may not be individual to the individual, but to the entire community as a whole, or a smaller section of the community as a whole. And this is where like separating out the personal data from this entire personal identifier. And here again, we are still going back to the definition, old school definition of, say, communities, which supposedly necessarily say has a bunch of people having names and real people, whereas we've kind of gone to the era where we are having virtual communities. We are having virtual communities of pseudonymous people. So, and these are all real for like years now. I mean, and these people also do have, let's say, community rights, but then that doesn't mean that any sort of personal data is embedded on them. Shweta, you're muted again.
And see, about the privacy is also about community data and personal and non-personal data.
Sorry,
Anivar, can you also, again, the same question I asked Shrikant, so yeah. About privacy and also about community, personal and non-personal data, and how is it possible?
One of the interesting examples coming to my mind is we were developing a morphological analyzer, and one of the major points in which it lacked accuracy was identifying the named entities. So named entity recognition, it need quite a lot of names, place names, maybe family names. So will it be personal data? And the NLP product we are developing whatever data, basically we are releasing this as open license data sets actually. So the categorization of non-personal data, basically what it does is it prevents the development itself. For example, maybe the accuracy of systems which may do the NLP systems may be affected when the named entity or other parts are basically removed from it. But at the same time, it is public good. Improving the accuracy is public good. So this conflict already exists. And second, one of the points Srikanth mentioned is the online virtual community part. And there is another interesting part is we also have the democratic communities, including the Gram Sabhas. So one of the projects we did was mapping a village, whole village for the purpose of the disaster rehabilitation exercise. So here, a Gram Sabha's rights to do something with its own data may need a society formation or a trust formation or a Section 8 company formation in this case, even if they are doing the work, right? So if they are handling their own. So this is online communities and online communities organized based upon their self-interest, which is a norm. We have existing practices and good practices, including the global communities building its own code of conduct and building their own social contracts and operating based upon that. So, but at the same time, when we place amorphous entity in a country like India, which is very communalized, which is very maybe racial and all those kind of thing, it also strengthens existing inequalities in one way. If it is not strengthening the democratic institutions as well as the virtual organizing possibilities. So the problem is here, the centralized authority and centralized more mode of managing data need to be more thought out before defining the community as some CSR trust kind of entity.
Thank you.
So there are language community, there are similar community initiatives building the in various segments. So those needs, at least study what are the community practices on data existing at this moment, and try to build it to the framework instead of building it from the bureaucratic, organizational, legal instrument building kind of view.
Right. So I think we're almost towards the end, so I'm just quickly rushing. So are there any audience questions? I can't.
Shweta, I just have a common short, response to both Tripti and Anivar. So one is first thing, so what Anivar mentioned, something in the previous round, I want to emphasize that. In fact, that is also something that we think is an opportunity lost in the personal data protection discourse that we've had. That is to make sure the state becomes an exemplar, right? So where the state is the model data controller. And similarly, when we want to look at, I mean, entities being regulated by this under the NPD regime, we also want the state to put itself to that standard, because particularly when we are looking at public good, right, the data with the state is overwhelmingly, I mean, more valuable in terms of public good value than a lot of the data that is with the private entities. So it's certainly true that, I mean, the state must put itself to be the model entity. If there are data sharing practices, etc., the state must be subject to it, and it must be a model to number. And number two, the second point was the one that Tripti made about this binary of personal data versus non-personal data is, that binary itself is, I mean, it's fuzzy, and it's the report fails to note that, and that is true. And particularly, we'll see once we have the final version of the personal data protection bill, perhaps it will, I mean, those concerns will probably be heightened by that, because we know that the 2019 version of it certainly is trying to define personal data in its own sort of vague terms. And we also see all of the rights under the personal data framework are going to be litigated upon. I'm not so sure that for us to be able to advocate, you know, not to have that distinction clear enough, whether it will help us assert our rights under the personal data framework better or not. Because as it is, it's already there. A lot of the rights, data protection rights, need to be litigated. And whether it's going to complicate things if that definition is not clear enough in the two reports, even if they don't get it correct. So long as it's clear and consistent, that's something that we must aim for.
Just thank you so much. So I was just going through the questions. We don't have any questions. I haven't received questions on YouTube, and we have around 4 minutes. So I can give each one of you all a minute to say what do you think is the next step or next hurdle that the NPD framework will have to go through in terms of implementation? So I can start with, okay, we just continue from there. So here, so what's the next implementation issue that might come through with the NPD framework?
Well, I don't know if they have enough buy-in as yet. So I certainly not among the civil society, certainly not among the industry bodies from as far as I can say. So I don't know how far the implementation will go, but there is absolutely no question that the time for such an NPD regulation has come. It came yesterday, right? Status quo, whenever we are evaluating an NPD framework, we have to also evaluate it against whether the continuance of the status quo, whether it is sustainable. I have my doubts over it. And irrespective of how the framework is, we would want to see sort of it kind of moving forward.
Tripti?
So in terms of, I don't know how implement, like, I don't even know where, how can they even start implementing this framework the way they have envisioned it so far, because I see a lot of gaps, even in terms of structure. So I think the first hurdle would be actually delineating the structure properly, because they have left a lot of loose definitions. So to tie all of them up in order to actually implement this framework as is, that needs to be done first. But I think there are more questions which are fundamental, which need to be resolved first before we even we begin to imagine the implementation of this framework. And I think all of us should make that noise and even write enough or whatever, do advocacy enough around that we are heard, that some of these fundamental focal points are even brought to notice and brought to attention, and even the state begins to ponder over them before implementing them. So that would be my
so I would refer to the illustrative implementation that's mentioned in the report, which seems to be like a very tech-heavy implementation. In fact, they suggest something like a policy markup language where the rules will be kind of baked into code. And they want, again, have a digital kind of system which basically enables all these data transfers between communities generate data, and then NPD gets shared, and then separately high-value data sets get hived off. This entire technology architecture or tech-heavy architecture of this in itself is something to look out for. What this also makes us is, Anivel was mentioning that this seems like a CSR kind of corporatized, nonprofit friendly. What this tech-heavy makes it, it's even more complex, is that your non-tech CSR would still be disadvantaged. So it's going to be, again, very high-tech enabled. If that illustrative implementation design is to anything to go by, that kind of poses an implementation challenge of its own. And as Prasanna said, that in itself could actually act as a model NPD. So will the NPD implementation kind of follow the guidelines proposed by itself, put up its own data as NPD, and so on? And will it stand the test of privacy? And can we kind of see who is accessing what and what frequency and so on. That kind of is just a meta implementation issue as well.
And finally, concluding remarks anywhere on this?
I think there is not much happening on NPD actually. So what it actually do is maybe allow people to do some tests around what is maybe building rails around it, which anyway industry or venture funds may explore at a parallelly. But at the same time, as a concept or framework, I think it is not going to fly at this time for a wider adoption.